Top 20 Narcissists Who Fucked Up. Hello, I'm H.G. Tudor, and welcome back to another part of our excellent series about narcissists that have fucked up. They've had fantastic, amazing, brilliant, privileged positions, but as a consequence of their narcissism and the creation of collateral consequences, they've fucked up. Sometimes it's public opinion that has caused a fall from grace. Sometimes it's decisions that people don't want to have any involvement with them. Sometimes it's as a consequence, and commonly, the application of the law, whether it's a civil judgment or criminal conviction, that has caused a fall from grace and a one-way ticket to fucked upsville for our members of this list. Make sure that you continue to offer in the comments who you think will also make this list, and make sure that you like these videos as well and get them shared. Now, are you ready? Are you comfortable? Jolly good. Then let us continue. In at number 12 in our countdown, it's Bill Cosby. Our next resident of Fucked Upsville finds himself languishing in the storeroom of a dilapidated 7-Eleven, trying to stuff the broken window with leftover scripts from his glory days when he was America's dad. Cosby began his career as a stand-up comic during the 1960s. Throughout the decade, he released several stand-up comedy records, which consecutively earned him the Grammy Award for Best Comedy Album from 1965 to 1970. He also had a starring role in the television crime show I Spy. He made history when he won the Primetime Emmy Award for Outstanding Lead Actor in a Drama Series in 1966, making him the first African-American to earn an Emmy Award for acting. In 1972, using the Fat Albert character developed during his stand-up routines, he hosted the animated comedy television series Fat Albert and the Cosby Kids. Throughout the 1970s, he starred in Sidney Poitier's Uptown Saturday Night, Let's Do It Again, Neil Simon's California Suite, alongside Richard Pryor. He also starred in the original cast of The Electric Company. In the 1980s, he produced and starred in the television sitcom The Cosby Show, which was rated as the number one show in America from 1985 through 1989. The sitcom highlighted the experiences and growth of an affluent African-American family. Cosby produced the spin-off sitcom A Different World. He also starred in The Cosby Mysteries, the sitcom Cosby, and hosted Kids Say the Darndest Things. He then created and produced the animated children's program Little Bill. He was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom by George W. Bush in 2002. On top of a prominent and stellar film and particularly prominent television career, Cosby was also making bank with advertising. He started with White Owl Cigars and later endorsed Jell-O Pudding and Gelatin, Del Monte, Ford Motor Company, Coca-Cola, American Red Cross, Texas Instruments, E.F. Hutton & Co., Kodak, and the 1990 United States Census. As of 2002, Cosby held the record for being the longest-serving celebrity spokesperson for a product through his work with Jell-O. In 2011, he won the President's Award for Contributions to Advertising from the Advertising Hall of Fame. Cosby was one of the first black people to appear in the United States as an advertising spokesperson. He was known for his appeal to white consumers in the second half of the 20th century, in an industry seen as slow to accept diversity. Well, all of these glowing plaudits doesn't look like someone who would be finding himself drinking rainwater from discarded shoes in Fucked Upsville, and yet that is what he ended up doing. What a weapons-grade helmet. Cosby decided that his life of luxury and adoration needed a serious correction, and therefore determined that he would ring 0800 Fuck My Career Up and ask for the sex case package, which is guaranteed to turn a hitherto loved and revered celebrity into one who is routinely spat on in public and the recipient of unwanted misshapen vegetables thrown at their heads. Yes, old Billy Boy went down the sex perv route, and it wasn't just a bit of handsy activity with an actress here or there when several sheets to the wind. Oh no, he really wanted to torpedo his reputation, and decided it was time to unleash his inner drugging rape fiend. Cosby didn't go half-cocked on his mission to move to fucked upville. This fellow was on a serious quest to ensure that he spent the rest of his life living on Beast Boulevard, staring at an unrelenting horizon of grey nothingness. Cosby faced a barrage of allegations. The early allegations against Cosby dated back to December 1965. In 2005, Christina Rulli came forward and alleged that Cosby had drugged and assaulted her at that time in his Beverly Hills home. In the early 1980s, Joan Tarshees alleged sexual assault by Cosby. In 1996, Playboy playmate Victoria Valentino gave a videotaped interview in which she made sexual assault allegations against Cosby. On February 1, 2000, Lachelle Covington, who was 20 years old at the time, filed a criminal complaint against Cosby, alleging that on January 28, 2000, at his Manhattan townhouse, he had tried to put her hands down his pants and then exposed himself. Covington also alleged that Cosby grabbed her breasts and tried to put his hand down her pants. In January 2004, Andrea Constand, a former Temple University employee, accused Cosby of drugging and fondling her. California lawyer Tamara Lucia Green came forward with allegations in February 2005 that Cosby had drugged and assaulted her in the 1970s. In a July 2005 interview, Beth Ferrier alleged that in 1984, Cosby had drugged her coffee and she awoke with her clothes partially removed. In 2005, Sean Upshaw Brown, a woman with whom Cosby admitted to having an extramarital affair in the 1970s, claimed that Cosby drugged and raped her the last two times the two were together sexually. Barbara Bauman reported two incidents that happened around early 1986, wherein she was 18 years old and working as an aspiring model and actress, after her agent had introduced her to Cosby and he had become her good friend and mentor, saying that she escaped his attacks and returned home to Denver. He thereafter subverted her career by way of response. On October 16, 2014, as part of a comedy routine in Philadelphia, Hannibal Buress addressed Cosby's legacy of talking down to young black men about their mode of dress and lifestyle. Buress criticized the actor's public moralizing by saying, "Yeah, but you raped women, Bill Cosby, so that kind of brings you down a couple of notches." The audience appeared to respond to Buress's accusation as an incredulous joke. Then he encouraged everyone to search Bill Cosby rape on Google when they got home. Buress had been using the same Cosby routine for the previous 6 months with little response. But word of the October performance spread rapidly after being posted on Philadelphia Magazine's website. After Buress's remarks came to the attention of journalist Joan Tarshees in November 2014, model Janice Dickinson, actress Louisa Moritz, actor Lufuengo's wife Carla, Florida nurse Therese Sarignes, Playboy playmates Valentino and Sarita Butterfield, actress Michelle Hurd, and 11 other women all made accusations of alleged assaults by Cosby, committed against them between 1965 and 2004. Beverly Johnson alleged that she was drugged by Cosby during a 1986 audition and that she knew other women with similar accounts. Cosby repeatedly denied the allegations and maintained his innocence. In November 2014, he responded to a question about the allegations and said, "I don't talk about it." Most of the allegations, however, fell outside of the statutes of limitation for criminal prosecution. Numerous civil lawsuits were brought against him. As of November 2015, 8 related civil suits were active against Cosby. In July 2015, some of the court records from Andrea Constand's 2005 civil suit against Cosby were unsealed and released to the public. The full transcript of his deposition was also released to the media by a court reporting service. In his testimony, Cosby admitted to casual sex involving the recreational use of the sedative methaqualone, Qualude, with a series of young women and acknowledged that his dispensing the prescription drug was illegal. Hell yeah. That plot had certainly been reserved in fucked upsville. Based on incidents in January 2004, Cosby was found guilty in 2018 of 3 counts of aggravated indecent assault against Andrea Constand after a jury trial. In September 2018, he was sentenced to 3 to 10 years in state prison and a $25,000 fine, plus court costs of both trials. Cosby appealed but lost and then brought a further appeal. On June 30th, 2021, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court overturned Cosby's conviction, citing violations of his due process rights, and he was freed from jail. But he'd already made it to fucked upsville. No problem at all. in the wake of the allegations, numerous organizations severed ties with Cosby, and honors and titles that were previously awarded to him had been revoked. Reruns of The Cosby Show and other shows featuring Cosby had been pulled from syndication by many organizations. 25 colleges and universities rescinded honorary degrees. Cosby even managed to drag a popular song to Fucked Upsville. In late 2018, the Christmas song Baby It's Cold Outside was pulled from several radio stations amid controversy that its lyrics allegedly promoted sexual predation. Susan Lisser, daughter of composer Frank Lisser, who wrote the song, blamed Cosby for the backlash against its lyric. "Say, what's in this drink?" Lisser said. "Bill Cosby is ruining it for everyone. Ever since Cosby was accused of drugging women, I hear the date rape thing all the time. I think it'd be good if people looked at the song in the context of the time. It was written in 1944. It was a different time." Following his release from prison in 2021, Cosby was reported to be attempting to make a post-prison comeback. Plans for the comeback included a comedy tour. It was also reported that Cosby was working on a 5-part docuseries that covered his legacy and his experience in prison, and that he was going to release a book. That September, however, it was reported that Cosby had cancelled his comeback plans for the time being after realising that once you arrive in Fucked Upsville, nobody leaves. Number 11. Amber Heard. Ah, yes. Here she is, Scamberturd. Depp abuser and shitter of the bed. A woman who found herself in the enviable position of being good-looking, a solid film career, and then broke the hearts of women around the world when she married Johnny Depp. This is a woman who should have sat proud in Smugsville, doing her best impression of a cat who got the cream. But instead, she applied for a transfer to Fucked Upsville so she could do bizarre court-based impressions of her dog stepping on a bee. Rather than get her pick of films, hang out at film premieres, pick up some beauty product advertising gigs, and wave at people whilst draped on Depp's arm, she found a red button in her handbag marked Activate Crazy and thought, hey, why don't I give this a press? Cue misplaced abuse allegations which backfired on her when her former husband unleashed the legal eagles on her. You don't need a repeat of the shit show that was the trial from last year to know what went on. There was enough poo in the bed without adding to it. But it certainly saw her packing up and moving to Fucked Upsville. Ridiculed on a daily basis with the televised coverage of the trial, her face launching memes left, right and centre, whilst Depp played it cool, she was massacred in the court of public opinion, despite the best efforts of certain vocal supporters to take down those who criticised her. After having her pants pulled down and getting a pink botty from being spanked in the court of public opinion, she ended up losing the case on aggregate and slunk away, hiding in Spain, where she faced a substantial legal bill and the need to make out a rather large cheque to one Mr. Depp. Depp demonstrated leniency, settling the case with her in December 2022 for a much lower sum, but Heard was on her way to Fucked Upsville. Branded a liar and an abuser, her various protestations in court ridiculed over and over, she found herself with no options in the world of film apart from an upcoming Aquaman film which has faced protests for her involvement. While she might not have ended up in the darkest parts of Fucked Upsville, she had everything on a plate for her and conspired to bugger it up by heading to Fucked Upsville, which segues rather neatly into another similar offender with our next resident of Fucked Upsville. Number 10. Harry's wife. We don't need to go into too much detail about this individual, seeing as I get to speak about her on most days, even though I'm sick and tired of doing so. Nevertheless, she is that unflushable turd, but she's an unflushable turd that has now moved to Fucked Upsville. This is a woman who basically came from not such a lot. She had a father that put her through school and gave her a leg up in her acting career. But she's a talent-free zone, beige as a child, beige as an adult. Not particularly intelligent, not especially good-looking, but nor ugly either. She was somebody that was destined really for a mundane office job, But somehow, as a consequence of the good offices of her father, she managed to wangle her way into the world of film and television. She didn't get any particularly major or plump parts, but eventually managed to hang around long enough on a cable show so that people took a little bit of notice of her. She then made her way amongst the Toronto scene, bolting on friends and acquiring them, and after a marriage to a television producer, which she dispensed of, started banging a chef. Thereafter, she hit the jackpot. She suddenly managed to ensnare a dim-witted ginger prince, the Prince of Pink Pancakes, Prince Harry. It was at this juncture she had it all. Worldwide recognition. People bending at the knee, kissing her elbow, running around doing what she more or less required. People supporting her. She could be mates with the fragrant Duchess of Cambridge, as she then was. She could inject a degree of modernity into the royal family, bringing to bear the fact that she was an American divorcee and also biracial. She had an opportunity to command an audience of billions around the globe who would likely listen to her, all because she married someone in the royal family. She didn't get there through talent. She didn't get there through hard work. She got there by simply sucking the knob of a tango-pubed halfwit. She got extremely lucky. And thus, she faced these following problems. Wealth, privilege, prominence, support, a staff, being praised where she went, and the opportunity to do much good in the world. And what did she do? She decided, in actual fact, I don't want to live in this cottage, which I've just had refurbished. I would much rather appear like a crazy bag lady walking the streets of fucked upsville, with a rictus grin and my ratty eyes staring at people. And thus, Harry's wife became another residence, joining the others of fucked upsville, as thereafter her sorry tale has seen her piss off the royals so they don't speak to her any longer, disengage from her father and her half-siblings so that they are moved to complain about her on television programmes, create an entire cottage industry that spends its days analysing everything that she does and criticising her, repeatedly mocking her, resulting in parody programs being generated by South Park, with comedians throwing in their views about her also. This is a woman who had it all, and as a consequence of her bleating and rampant victimhood, decided, do you know what? I'd much rather be a resident of fucked upsville, and instead be trying to squirt the last of the tomato ketchup from the bottle onto a cracker for my evening meal. She had the opportunity to have so much go well for her in life, having come essentially from very little. But her narcissism caused her to throw all of that away. Not only did she throw away all of those advantages, that the early advantages that she got herself into as a consequence of her connection, namely, some people would actually tolerate her and talk to her, and also some dimwits at companies decided that they would throw millions of dollars in her direction, she even managed to bugger that up as well. She got hold of public goodwill and basically threw it out of the window. She was so lazy, she couldn't be bothered to create a proper podcast series, with the result that Spotify said, no more. Netflix have decided they're not particularly happy with her either. And then all of a sudden, the popularity that she first enjoyed, the warmth with which she was greeted when she first moved to the United Kingdom, evaporated. Instead, she became that smelly fart that nobody dares breathe in, and they all want to run away from. Not even the deluded sugars, whose numbers have started to dwindle as she can no longer afford to pay the bots, and certain people are waking up to the fact that she's a complete twat, has resulted in more and more people mocking her, laughing her, as a tsunami of ridicule bears down on her. Her husband apparently doesn't want to hang around with her as much as he once did, notwithstanding the fact that he remains caught in her manipulations. And this is an individual who had so much given to her on a plate and has just thrown it away. She spunked her money and apparently is heading at Brokeville. She has got rid of her popularity, watching it tank in the United Kingdom, then the United States, and then in other countries. She is very much a resident of Fucked Upsville. At the moment, she's found herself in the suburbs, but it's not going to be long until she finds herself in the darkest, most destitute parts of Fucked Upsville, and we'll probably be revisiting that. Number 9, Harvey Weinstein. Sex offender and once upon time film producer, walking just about scrotum, Harvey Weinstein held a supposedly unassailable position in Hollywood, wielding massive power after having co-founded the entertainment company Miramax, which produced several successful independent films, including Sex, Lies and Videotape, The Crying Game, Pulp Fiction, Heavenly Creatures, Flirting with the Disaster, Shakespeare in Love. Weinstein won an Academy Award for producing Shakespeare in Love and also won 7 Tony Awards for plays and musicals, including The Producers, Billy Elliot the Musical, and August Osage County. After leaving Miramax, Weinstein and his brother, Bob, founded the Weinstein Company, TWC, a mini-major film studio. He was co-chairman, alongside Bob, from 2005 to 2017. Weinstein should have been chomping on a cigar with a shit-eating grin, having champagne poured over him by a passing parade of scantily clad A-list actresses, enjoying having his backside kissed routinely by both male and female movie stars. But instead, he thought, "Do you know what? I fancy being a sexual deviant, and instead make my way at a leisurely stroll to Fucked Upsville. Balls to the high life, I really fancy getting scrotal itch in a prison cell in Satan's rectum, otherwise known as Fucked Upsville." And lo, it came to pass that a wealthy and powerful movie magnate signed up for a transfer to Fucked Upsville. In October 2017, following sexual abuse allegations dating back to the late 1970s, Weinstein was dismissed from his company and expelled from the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. More than 80 women made allegations of sexual harassment or rape against Weinstein by October the 31st. The allegations sparked the hashtag MeToo social media campaign and subsequent sexual abuse allegations against many powerful men around the world. This phenomenon is referred to as the Weinstein effect. Yes, he's even got his own shitty effect named after him. Weinstein was arrested and charged with rape in New York in May 2018. And was found guilty of 2 of 5 felonies in February 2020. Weinstein was sentenced to 23 years in prison and began serving his sentence at Wendy Correctional Facility. In October 2022, Weinstein was charged with 11 counts of rape, forcible oral copulation and sexual battery, stemming from alleged acts between 2004 and 2013. He was found guilty of 3 of 7 charges. 4 of the initial 11 charges were dropped. On December the 19th, 2022. Convictions included charges of rape, forced oral copulation, and third-degree sexual misconduct. On the February 23rd, 2023, Weinstein was sentenced to 16 years in prison for these convictions. His sentence in California prisons must be served separately, i.e. consecutively to, rather than concurrently to, his time served in New York. Now the man, who was a major power broker in the industry, must spend his time in a prison cell, with his rotting teeth, as he looks out of the window at the dusty plains of Fucked Upsville, the scorching heat of his humiliation turning him into a shuffling, ambling, sweaty ballsack. Thus, our next 4 residents of Fucked Upsville have been described. But there are 8 more. Who do you think they are, as we hot up in terms of the depth of the fall from grace that these people have experienced? Stay tuned in part 2 for more.